Good evening, good evening, good evening, my friends. Welcome to day number 8, part 1 of this beautiful book, The Purpose-Driven Life, written by Pastor Rick Warren. If you have comments or questions, we'll be happy to engage those questions and comments if you would kindly put them in the comment section of this video.
Day 8, thinking about my purpose. Point to ponder: I was planned for God's pleasure. Verse to remember: the Lord takes pleasure in His people. Psalm 149:4 TEV. Question to consider: what common task could I start doing as if I were doing it directly for Jesus? 9. What makes God smile? May the Lord smile on you. Numbers 6:25 NLT. Smile on me, your servant. Teach me the right way to live. Psalm 119:135 Message: the smile of God is the goal of your life. Since pleasing God is the first purpose of your life, your most important task is to discover how to do that. The Bible says, figure out what will please Christ, and then do it. Fortunately, the Bible gives us a clear example of a life that gives pleasure to God. The man's name was Noah. In Noah's day, the entire world had become morally bankrupt. Everyone lived for their own pleasure, not God's. God couldn't find anyone on earth interested in pleasing Him, so He was grieved and regretted making a man. God became so disgusted with the human race that He considered wiping it out, but there was one man who made God smile. The Bible says, Noah was a pleasure to the Lord. God said, this guy brings me pleasure. He makes me smile. I'll start over with his family, because Noah brought pleasure to God. You and I are alive today. From his life we learn the 5 acts of worship that make God smile. God smiles when we love Him supremely. Noah loved God more than anything else in the world, even when no one else did. The Bible tells us that for his entire life, Noah consistently followed God's will and enjoyed a close relationship with Him. This is what God wants most from you: a relationship. It's the most astounding truth in the universe that our Creator wants to fellowship with us. God made you to love you, and He longs for you to love Him back. He says, I don't want your sacrifices, I want your love. I don't want your offerings, I want you to know me. Can you sense God's passion for you in this verse? God deeply loves you and desires your love in return. He longs for you to know Him and spend time with Him. This is why learning to love God and be loved by Him should be the greatest objective of your life. Nothing else comes close in importance. Jesus called it the greatest commandment. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. God smiles when we trust Him completely. The second reason Noah pleased God was that he trusted God, even when it didn't make sense. The Bible says, by faith, Noah built a ship in the middle of dry land. He was warned about something he couldn't see, and acted on what he was told. As a result, Noah became intimate with God. Imagine this scene. One day God comes to Noah and says, I'm disappointed in human beings. In the entire world, no one but you thinks about me. But Noah, when I look at you, I start smiling. I'm pleased with your life. So I'm going to flood the world and start over with your family. I want you to build a giant ship that will save you and the animals. There were 3 problems that could have caused Noah to doubt. First, Noah had never seen rain, because prior to the flood, God irrigated the earth from the ground up. Second, Noah lived hundreds of miles from the nearest ocean. Even if he could learn to build a ship, how would he get it to water? Third, there was the problem of rounding up all the animals and then caring for them. But Noah didn't complain or make excuses. He trusted God completely, and that made God smile. Trusting God completely means having faith that He knows what is best for your life. You expect Him to keep His promises, help you with problems, and do the impossible when necessary. The Bible says, He takes pleasure in those that honor Him, in those who trust in His constant love. It took Noah 120 years to build the ark. I imagine he faced many discouraging days. With no sign of rain year after year, he was ruthlessly criticized as a crazy man who thinks God speaks to him. I imagine Noah's children were often embarrassed by the giant ship being built in their front yard. Yet Noah kept on trusting God. In what areas of your life do you need to trust God completely? Trusting is an act of worship. Just as parents are pleased when children trust their love and wisdom, your faith makes God happy. The Bible says, "Without faith it is impossible to please God." God smiles when we obey Him wholeheartedly. Saving the animal population from a worldwide flood required great attention to logistics and details. Everything had to be done just as God prescribed it. God didn't say, "Build any old boat you'd like, Noah." He gave very detailed instructions as to the size, shape, and materials of the ark, as well as the different numbers of animals to be brought on board. The Bible tells us Noah's response. So Noah did everything exactly as God had commanded him. Trusting God completely means having faith that He knows what is best for your life. Notice that Noah obeyed completely. No instruction was overlooked. And he obeyed exactly, in the way and time God wanted it done. That is wholeheartedness. It is no wonder God smiled on Noah. If God asked you to build a giant boat, don't you think you might have a few questions, objections, or reservations? Noah didn't. He obeyed God wholeheartedly. That means doing whatever God asks without reservation or hesitation. You don't procrastinate and say, "I'll pray about it." You do it without delay. Every parent knows that delayed obedience is really disobedience. God doesn't owe you an explanation or reason for everything He asks you to do. Understanding can wait, but obedience can't. Instant obedience will teach you more about God than a lifetime of Bible discussions. In fact, you will never understand some commands until you obey them first. Obedience unlocks understanding. Often we try to offer God partial obedience. We want to pick and choose the commands we obey. We make a list of the commands we like and obey those while ignoring the ones we think are unreasonable, difficult, expensive, or unpopular. I'll attend church but I won't tithe. I'll read my Bible but won't forgive the person who hurt me. Yet partial obedience is disobedience. Wholehearted obedience is done joyfully, with enthusiasm. The Bible says, "Obey Him gladly." This is the attitude of David. "Just tell me what to do and I will do it, Lord. As long as I live I'll wholeheartedly obey." James, speaking to Christians, said, "We please God by what we do and not only by what we believe." God's word is clear that you can't earn your salvation. It comes only by grace, not your effort. But as a child of God you can bring pleasure to your Heavenly Father through obedience. Any act of obedience is also an act of worship. Why is obedience so pleasing to God? Because it proves you really love Him. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will obey my commandments." God smiles when we praise and thank Him continually. Few things feel better than receiving heartfelt praise and appreciation from someone else. God loves it, too. He smiles when we express our adoration and gratitude to Him. Noah's life brought pleasure to God because he lived with a heart of praise and thanksgiving. Noah's first act after surviving the flood was to express his thanks to God by offering a sacrifice. An amazing thing happens when we offer praise and thanksgiving to God. When we give God enjoyment, our own hearts are filled with joy.
Thank you so much for joining us on Evening Reflection this evening. As we go through these lessons, may I ask you to share this link. Share this channel with as many pastors, church leaders, friends, associates, contacts, as you know, who may benefit from the lessons that are being presented from this book. God bless you.